Having faith alone is not sufficient. But if you blend it with deeds in this part of the world, make people know that God is in their midst.
You have to get out of your comfort room, go back to the people, see their miseries, touch them with the love of God.
We found them in the street and we took them, and they're with us today.
It's not what you do, but it's the love that you put into the doing.
Hello and welcome to a time of excitement and inspiration. I am Manoj Sanni, and together with Shalom World, we'll take you through the journeys of a group of ordinary people in the Jesus Youth Movement who dared to follow an extraordinary call as a part of the full-time volunteer project. A project that has been instilling the missionary lifestyle in young people for the last 28 years. A project that has put 28 batches of young people, around 2,000 so far, through a 30-day intensive training and placing them in mission centers around the world for a whole year. And that's exactly why they are called God's crazy people. Today we have a young person joining us from UAE, son of Dominic Savio and Lovesy Dominic, and the beloved brother of Danny Dominic. He's a chartered accountant by profession and holds a master's in finance. He attended the International Full-Timers Training in Thailand in 2010 and took a commitment in Cambodia. He works as a finance controller for a prestigious firm in Dubai and lives with his wife, Tushara, and three kids. Ronnie Dominic from UAE. Ronnie, a hearty welcome.
Thank you, Manoj. Thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity.
Ronnie, let me start with a basic question. How did you start your journey with the Lord? What is the moment of encounter with Jesus in your life?
My parents are charismatic. My parents are, we've been brought up in a very, very traditional Catholic family. So we have regular prayer meetings and we're going for these charismatic meetings and all that. So in a way, I thought I was religious. I thought I was, you know, close to Jesus. Just after, in my grade 12th, I was introduced to, we were starting a new ministry called the Jesus Youth Teens Ministry in Dubai. And we started that program, that ministry with the launch of a teens retreat. So it was at this retreat that that really changed my whole understanding or perspective of faith, where the retreatant, Brother Fritz, he challenged us actually. You really need to have a relationship with Jesus. All my life, I've been trying to be someone or to do something else or to try to be the popular ones. But in that retreat, God made me realize, Ronnie, I just want to be you. And I just want to develop a passionate relationship with you. So that blew my mind away. And by God's grace, I've been able to keep that relationship. So since then, I know that I have a relationship with Jesus. So that's how I came into the movement. And that's how I came into the Jesus Youth Teens Ministry.
Ronnie, you seems to be very good in your studies. And you were one among five of the country finalists for the Chartered Institute of Management Accountant Global Business Challenge. That's what I heard from your friends. Naturally, you would have been very focused in your career. Then why did you decide to attend the full-timers training and to take this one-year commitment?
Actually, this is my most biggest fear before taking commitment was this. Oh my God, this is going to ruin my career. Like, how can you explain a career gap? How can you explain taking a one-year break, especially the most productive part after your college time, you're taking a one-year, like how can you explain to colleges or to recruiters that, you know, so during this, the first time I heard about full-timership, I heard it from Rijo and Jomit. It was their mission places to Northeast India. So they came to me and they were telling they resigned from their jobs and they went. And then they came back and I was like, how can you even think of doing this? Like, this is, it's so crazy. But then he said, like, they just let go of that and God took care of it. Like give your first fruits to the Lord. And like your first, if there's a harvest, you offer the first fruits to the Lord. So Ronnie, give your first fruits, like your time after your college is the most precious time, right? You give that to God and see how he's going to manifest it. See how wonderfully he's going to change that. So I took that to the heart. And till now, I have no regrets. My jobs, even now, the third job I am in, I have got specifically hired because they asked me, wow, what did you do? What did you do in this 1 year? And I got a time to really explain. So all my life, I was fearful that this career break or this mission was going to ruin my career, but never, it was never like that. It was a wrong misconception I had. It has only allowed me to get better jobs, to engage good conversations. My mission only helped in my career.
Let me go more about what happened during that 1 year time. Okay, how was Bangkok? Did you enjoy it? What was the experience in Bangkok?
It actually blew my mind away. I was going there with this attitude that, you know what? Okay, I'm giving my 1 year to God. I'm going to change the world. And, you know, I'm going to make so much big decisions in my life. And then in the first day of the training, they like really broke us apart. Like saying, you are here to change yourself and to change others by showing them the change in you. That was one very big eye-opener for me. So this 30 days in Bangkok changed my life with beautiful friends, amazing resources, amazing talks, more of the times spending more time in prayer with the Eucharistic adoration in Mass. This really changed my life, really changed my perspective of how I need to see my mission.
I was reminded of the scripture, okay, stay in the city until you are clothed with the power from on high. I think that is happening in Bangkok. And then you were placed in Cambodia. There were a lot of confusions. Yeah. And for you anyway, culture, food, language, everything was different. How did you manage? And what was the nature of mission in Cambodia?
Well, so usually Jesus Youth full-timers, when we are placed in some countries, if it's a country that's well established, Jesus Youth full-timers will stay with the families or a JY home or something like that. But for us, since Mission Cambodia was a very early stage, we partnered with the Salesians, with the Don Bosco Foundation. We got an opening there where they wanted volunteers to help them in running their school, to help them like English teachers, to help them to teach their boys in welfare schooling and all that. So the previous two full-timers had made a good mark there, and they were very, very interested to bring in Jesus Youth full-timers. I was taking care of the welfare of a boys called Besuko Boys. So I was like teaching them English, coaching them in sports, things which I've never done in my life before, but I was able to do that. And then whenever in the evenings we are free or in the weekends when we are not working in the Don Bosco Foundation, we should travel out, meet the our nearby parishes, engage with the youth, because that was our primary objective, you know, to build good networks around Cambodia, to build a good network of youth friendships around. So that was our primary objective. So as and when we got in the evenings, we're free, or in the weekends, we will travel around and try to make. So this was more of the nature of Cambodian mission.
Ronnie, before we continue with our discussions, I have a surprise for you. Joining us now, one of the key leaders of the Jesus Youth Movement, George Devasi from India. He was a former Southeast Asia coordinator and the international coordinator of Jesus Youth Movement. He runs a very successful business in Cochin, Kerala, and lives with his wife, Nimi, and three kids. George.
Ronnie was one sweet and tough guy. Well, I met him first in Dubai, and he was working with the teens ministry there. And he was one active guy. He would be always on the move. And what was special about him was he would be working in the grassroots and working with the young people, and he would be always full of questions. I know he used to have at least 10 questions in one question. On one side, he was a very sweet guy. A very jovial person who was always spreading joy around him. But at the same time, he would have in these 10 questions some really tough ones. So when you meet Ronnie, it's always, I used to tell myself, you better be prepared. He wanted to know the why and the how immediately. And as soon as he knew, there would be no time wasted to just do it. He would be investigating all the time how he would be able to do ministry better. How would he able to enhance his skills as a missionary, a young missionary? And then he was placed in Cambodia. I used to pray, a very sweet guy placed in a very tough mission. And as expected, he would call, and his calls would be like a rapid fire Q&A. And some of the questions he would be answering himself. And it's a little funny, but after everything is over, there would be a pause. And that's when you know that you need to talk. So his phone calls used to be very unique. And one thing about Ronnie would be, he would always be on the move. And at the end, he would have a whole set of challenges to be overcome. And then he would end his conversations by saying that, we need to do it. And he had the faith that it will happen. And it did happen. You know, it was a tough set of documentations that we were able to crack. So, Ronnie, what should I say? I would like to know, how do you, from a very sweet guy like the person that you are, a very jovial person, born and brought up in Dubai, how did you re-engineer yourself to be so effective in Cambodia?
Good question to continue our discussion, Ronnie. Thank you, George.
Wow. Okay. that was a surprise, actually. Never expected to hear like this from George. And yeah, when I was young itself, people always says that I'm so restless. I'm just trying to get things done. And this has been always, I think, God-given fire, but really enkindled when I came into the movement. To always, no matter what, imagine there is fire on your back, and just keep doing it, and spread the flame of Christ, spread the flame, Jesus flame, everywhere possible. Because my life really changed the moment I accepted Jesus as my Savior. My life changed upside down, or from downside up, it came in a correct way after developing this personal relationship with Jesus. So even so. That fire combined with my restlessness, I was able to positively use it for God's kingdom, to do things, to make sure, running around, to make sure we are giving the best to Jesus in all the things possible. So wherever possible, I got a chance, in whichever ministry I served, whichever programs I did, I always would try to give the best to Jesus.
Praise God, Ronnie. But I'm sure that your time there in Cambodia was not a bed of roses. What were some of the challenges you faced during that year?
See, I'm like a typical Dubai kid, you know, born and brought up. Okay, we had a good shelter, good bed. We had AC every nook and corner because it's Dubai. Even our bus stops were AC. So we were a little bit pampered here. So going there, I was a little bit worried how I'm going to stay, how I'm going to live. So my mission partner, Donna, when I put her bag in her room in Cambodia, because she was a teacher, she had her own room and AC and all that. I'm like, okay, so this is not bad. So I will also get a similar room. But then when they showed to my place, it was a big hall and one with like 50, 60 beds. And the corner is my bed. And said, Ronnie, you have to take care of these children, and your privacy will be one curtain we will install for you. And the fan is like 1 kilometer away. So this is what my first reaction on the first day in Cambodia. So then that day, I like, okay, God, I knew God specifically sent me to Cambodia to form me, to mold me. So that was one of the challenge, living there. Food was a big, big challenge. I lost almost 10 kilos during my 1 year there, adjusting with rice and ketchup. Then the one difficult challenge was the language. The people there do not speak English primarily. They speak the language called Khmer. So we have to learn the language. So we had 3 months of a crash course to learn the language. This helped us to do Nimbang, Pisai, Khmer, Tik Tik. I can speak Khmer a little bit. So this was a big challenge. So even if you're talking to people, if you want to develop a deep connection with people, I needed a translator with me. And this was one big hurdle to overcome. So we had to really focus on learning the language. And we were able to speak a little bit Khmer here and there. But eventually, whenever we went out to do talks, I think there was a translator with us.
Any memorable experiences during your commitment year?
We got an opportunity to do a retreat. And we were like, as usual, typical Jesus youths, what we would do is we would call our national council, central council, and say, send resources. And they will try to send someone. So when we called our mission directors, they were like, no, we are not sending anybody. You guys have to be the resources. You have to do it. So that was one big shock for us because we were young. We had no clue how to do retreats or to... We have basic experience, but we've not been there doing that. So then that week sat down. We started preparing for the retreat. It's fully in Khmer. We had a translator. The videos we prepared with Khmer subtitles and from scratch, completely from scratch. The PowerPoints, we did it in Khmer with small English footnotes for me to understand. But for them, they were saying, so when this retreat got over, like when we did this two days program, there were these priests and nuns who were also attending the retreat with us. And they were like actually also taking notes. And it was very, very humbling to see. And after that, they came to us and said, like, Ronnie, 5-6 years we've been doing retreats and never we've had young people do the talks. And we could clearly see all of them are very well engaged. You use the new technologies, you use PowerPoint, you use videos. We've never had this kind of, in a very rural retreat, it's in a very, very village center, to use projector and to bring a projector there and to show them. So for them, it was a really, really eye-opening experience. For us, we were thinking, oh my God, we are not even doing to any justice to the levels of the retreat. But we could see that our standard is definitely, God had another plan. God really, a beautiful time of anointing, beautiful time of adorations. God used us as a beautiful instruments to help them experience this kind of a retreat experience. So, and all this while, we've been trying to say, you know, we should start Jesus prayer groups, Jesus prayer meetings, and we didn't have any opening, nothing was like that. But after this retreat, after these two, three retreats we organized, they only came to us and said, oh, you know what, can you tell us more about Jesus youth? We want to be Jesus youth ourselves. Can we set up prayer meetings? So that's when like, wow, our eyes opened. So God really had those. So that's one of the most beautiful times, beautiful memories I have in Cambodia.
Probably my final question to you. What do you want to share with the youth of today?
Well, I tell my friends here when I'm speaking to them, always think outside the box. So even when you're doing anything for God, anything you do, don't settle for mediocre level activities. Think like give your best to God. That'll blow your mind away. You'll see how God multiplies your little idea to make it wonderful, marvelous things.
This is one of the challenges of Pope Francis places in front of the young people whenever he meets them. I'm taking this from one of his famous tweets. Do not be content to live a mediocre Christian life. Walk with determination along the path of holiness. He repeated it on several occasions saying, dear young people, let us not be satisfied with a mediocre life. Be amazed by what is true and beautiful and what is of God. Thank you, Ronnie, for placing this challenge in front of us. And thank you very much for this time of inspiration. It was great having you with us on this show. May the Lord protect you and guide you. And may you continue to be a blessing.
Thank you. Thank you, Manoj. Thank you, Shalom World. Good job.
Friends, we are talking about a special call. And we are all set to meet a very special person who can shed more light on this journey, much more than anyone else in this world. So here is a special guest for the day, Baby Chako, a retired Air Force officer from Kerala, who has accompanied the full-timers as the animator of the trainings for the last 26 years. Over all these years, he continued as a link between these batches and their animating teams. He presently serves as animator of the Jesus Youth International Formation Team. Baby Chako.
My involvement with the Jesus Youth Full-Timers Project was quite accidental. Being the director of Emmaus, first batch of full-timers training, I was involved with them partially. But then after the training, they were mostly associated with the daily activities of Emmaus, the Charismatic Center. First batch of full-timers were placed in different zones and campuses in Kerala. We being the first fresh group, they had no idea or clarity about what they were to do. But then being associated with these youngsters, it was more beneficial for me also. These young people taking a 1 year commitment, the 27 of them, they became very friendly with me and I used to help them to the best of my capacity. So batch after batch, it continued. And though there was no clarity about whether to continue next batch, it went on by the power of the Holy Spirit, by the special grace of the Holy Spirit. So after a few batches, the training itself was shifted from Malayalam to English. Then missionaries were sent to the mission areas of India missions, Catholic missions. Then it was, trainings were held in Delhi, as well as in Calicut, and also gradually to international training, which was first batch was in Colombo, Sri Lanka, then shifted to Bangkok. Anyway, for the last 26 years, I was associated with them. And in fact, I can tell that I am benefited by involving with them, perhaps more than what they benefited. Because being with young missionaries, it was so thrilling, so enriching. I really feel that I was really helped by being with them. Even today, all these batches keep in touch with me. I am with thousands of them, wherever they are in the world. I know them, they keep in touch with me. And I'm so happy that we have a bunch, a big family of full-timers active and with their special logo of lifelong commitment. Praise the Lord.
Thank you very much, Baby Chaco, for sharing about the evolution and growth of full-timers training. As I shared, we have four such trainings happening every year now. Two trainings in India, in English and in our national language, Hindi, and another one in Thailand for the international participants, and the next one in Uganda for the participants from Eastern Africa. So if any one of you listening to me now is inspired to answer a similar call and have a heart to work with the youth, do get in touch with us. So that's it for today, friends. Let's keep each other in prayer and stay crazy for God until we meet again next week for the same program on Shalom World. For more exciting contents, watch shalomworld.org and download the free apps of Shalom World on your iOS and Android devices. Thank you.
Are you looking for life-changing entertainment? Does what you see on most channels leave you feeling unfulfilled? Well, look no further. Shalom World TV brings the peace and joy of Jesus Christ to you, whether at home or on the go. To start watching, you don't need antennas, cable connections, or a dish. You probably already have what you need, if you have a smart TV, such as a Samsung, LG, or Panasonic, or if you have one with an Android, Opera, or Roku TV operating system. These can be found on the latest models of Sony, Toshiba, Vizio, Philips, RCA, Sharp Aquos, TCL, Insignia, Element, Hitachi, Vestal, Skyworth, Changhong, Konica, and Hisense. You can also watch Shalom TV on most IPTV streaming devices, starting with the fourth generation of Apple TV and Roku, Amazon Fire TV, Mi Box, Amino, Humax, or on TiVo Box through the Opera TV store. Are you a gamer or virtual reality enthusiast? We've got you covered. Shalom World is on Xbox One, Razer Forge, NVIDIA Shield, and HoloLens. To start watching, all you have to do is go to the App Store, download Shalom World, and start being fulfilled by content that brings you into a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ. For more information on how to watch Shalom World on your TVs and devices, visit us at shalomworld.org/connectedTV. Have a smartphone or tablet? Take Shalom with you wherever you go. Again, by downloading Shalom World from the App Store. If you prefer to watch from your Mac or PC, get the Shalom World desktop app. Or you can always watch from our website, shalomworld.org. And guess what? Shalom World is absolutely free on all of these platforms. Yes, free. there are no download charges and no in-store app purchases required, ever. If you're looking for life-changing entertainment, you found it. It's here, waiting for you on your Shalom World.